Welcome to Perry's Victory and International Peace Memorial. And welcome to our virtual Perry Education Days talk on I Thought That Was a Cannon. I'm Ranger Rob, and today I'm dressed as a sailor from the War of 1812. Blue coat, red vest, white pants, black tarred hat. And behind me is one of the stars of Perry's Victory. That is our 32-pound Carronade. Now you know where we got the name. Thought it was a cannon. Do not feel bad. Before I even started working here, I would have thought the same thing. Something big, black, that you put black powder in, and you put a cannonball in, and goes boom. Has to be a cannon, right? That's all it is. Well, what is a carronade? Well, it's a type of naval artillery. First used during pretty much the American Revolution through about 1820, so just after the War of 1812, very short-lived. So what is the carronade? Well, we can compare it and contrast it to what a cannon is. That 32 part in it is the size cannonball it would fire. It would have fired a 32-pound cannonball. So to take a cannon that would fire a 32-pound cannonball, you are looking at something over 10 foot long. This is only about 5 foot long, so it's half the size. A 32-pound cannon, you're looking at close to 3 tons worth of metal. This is only about a ton. So 2,000 pounds versus 6,000 pounds. So it's a lot lighter. Other differences include how much powder it takes. Full service charge on this is just over 2 pounds of powder or so. You'd need at least 8 pounds of powder for a 32-pound cannon. Number of men, full crew on a cannon, a 32-pound cannon, you're looking at maybe 16 men. We use 6 people here to load and fire this gun. Historically, in a pinch, in the Battle of Lake Erie, 2 guys can load and fire this. So it takes a lot less men. In a pinch with a cannon, you probably still need 4 or 5 guys just to haul that 3-ton gun up into place so you can shoot it. Other differences, cannons traditionally come on a garrison or a naval truck, which has little wheels. Do you see any wheels on this? No. This gun's mounted to the side of the ship. You have to imagine that red beam there is the side of the vessel. And you got 2 little wheels back here for left and right, not backwards and forwards. The other difference is you got the skid in the sled here for it to slide back and forth. So if you've ever heard the saying, grease the skid, we got grease there so it will move forward. So that's just some of the physical differences between this and a cannon. Now, the fact that it is smaller, it uses less powder. There comes the one major downside to this gun. A cannon can reach out, hit something over 1 mile away, accurate to about 1/2 mile. The carronade here, you can hit something maybe 1/2 mile away, accurate to less than 1/4 mile. That is a big difference. However, once you got within that 1/4 mile range, this gun will actually be more accurate and will do more damage than a traditional cannon. This will get the nickname Ship Smasher. Who would use this gun? Well, it's lightweight, doesn't shoot as far. If you're a merchant ship out on the high seas and you get those bandits called pirates that might want to attack you, you want a little insurance, protection. Do you want a big, heavy cannon on board? Or would you rather have a carronade to scare them off? Takes less men, less powder, less space. Because you put a 3-ton gun on your deck, that's 3 tons of whatever goods you're hauling that you cannot haul. So that's important. Weight's important. Now, if you're a naval vessel, ocean-going vessel like the U.S. frigate Constitution, or the HMS Victory for the British, you have multiple gun decks. you can put your big, heavy cannons down low, and you put your lighter weight carronades on the open deck, upper decks. Why would you do that? Well, with your cannons lower, you can fight a long range battle, fight half mile away or more. But as you get closer, then your carronades can kick in and can do more damage. So how did this play into the Battle of Lake Erie? Well, when the Navy was building their vessels out here on Lake Erie, they designed them to sail on the Great Lakes. They're shallow draft because Lake Erie is the shallowest of the Great Lakes. You could only put so much weight on these smaller vessels then before they became top heavy or they couldn't sail right. So you had to adjust your armament. How are you going to arm your vessels? I didn't say this earlier, but a 32-pound carronade weighs about and takes up about the same amount of room as a 12-pound cannon. So you're looking at this for the Lawrence and the Niagara, Perry's two big brigs. They can hold 20 guns. How do you want to arm them? 20 12-pounders that can hit something a mile away, accurate to a half mile? Or do you want 20 of these that can hit something a half mile away, accurate to about a quarter of a mile? Decisions, decisions. You can only put so many guns on it. Perry chooses to arm this vessel with 18 of these carronades. And then the last two spots go to cannon. So he does have some minor long-range capability when he goes into battle. Now, the smaller vessels, some of them are only big enough to hold one or two guns no matter what size they are. So Perry's smaller vessels, many of them will end up with cannons. So now when Perry goes into battle, he has smaller vessels with long range capability, and he has his big vessels with the short range capability. He can fight a long range or short range battle. Now the British, they have all sorts of guns. The Queen Charlotte, the second largest British vessel, is carronades, but they're 24 pounders, so they're smaller than this. The Detroit, the flagship for the British squadron, never really got its shipment of guns. So what guns does the Detroit have? Whatever the Army could give them. There are 9-pounders, there's 18-pounders, there's 12, maybe a 24-pounder. There is, and these are all cannons, but they're various sizes. There is no consistency. The wind has to get him in close so he can fight. But once they're fighting, what are they gonna shoot out of these guns? Well, there's cannonballs. That's the traditional thing. Hit the side of the ship, gonna rip that wood to pieces, send splinters flying. There are no explosive shots back then, so these are all solid shots. The British military and other militaries are starting to experiment with exploding ones. Then you have chain shot. You got two cannonballs hooked together with a piece of chain. What are you gonna use that for? Aim for the rigging. There's also bar shot. Why would you do that? Well, if you can take out their rigging, they cannot sail. They cannot maneuver because these vessels are armed with their guns pointing out their side. They cannot turn the vessel. They cannot turn their guns. So that's another part. Then you have grape shot. This is, if you look at it, looks like a bundle of grapes. It's 9 small cannonballs covered in burlap or canvas with a rod and a disc on the bottom, rod up through the center. It looks like a bundle of grapes. That's anti-personnel, that you'd aim that for the side of the ship and people. Then you had canister shot, just that tin can filled with really little cannonballs or big musket balls. Turn your carronade, your cannon into a shotgun. And the final thing you could shoot out of these guns, langrage. This is the homemade version of canister round. You don't have enough of that, you don't have enough of anything else. Well, we got some sail, canvas. Let's sew it up into a little bag, throw whatever we have laying around, nails, glass, stones, whatever. Whether it's a cannon or a carronade, there is one thing in common on the inside of that gun. None of them are rifled. So if you can load it into the barrel of that gun, you can shoot it. How effective it is another question. Now the Battle of Lake Erie, that comes into play. U.S. sailor looks around, he's out of ammunition. What's he gonna do? Ooh, there's a crowbar or a boarding axe, something like that. He loads up his gun and fires that at the British. Oh no, he's out of crowbars. What's he gonna use now? Well, looks around, there's a small, probably deck gun or something. Loads, small cannon, loads that into the barrel of his big cannon and tries shooting that at the British. Now for loading in that of this gun. If you watch the musket demonstration, people often ask, what's the difference between artillery and muskets? Really, the only thing is size. A musket, one person can load and fire. This, yeah, in a pinch, two people can do it. But safely, you're looking at a crew of five or six men. You got one guy that's tending vent, doing the priming. You have another guy that's loading. You have another guy that's ramming. You have another guy that actually is sort of the trigger puller and pulls it. So all these steps are important. Everyone has their own job. It's just that since it's bigger, more people need to do it. So that morning, September 10th, Perry's lookout spout the British out on the horizon. They make sail, head out that way. Wind is not in Perry's favor. He has to sail into it. He's tacking, he's zigzagging back and forth between South Bass and Rattlesnake Island. Finally, after hours of fighting the wind, he finally decides to turn around. He's gonna fight the battle at a disadvantage. Because as Perry's issuing that order to turn around, the wind shifts 180 degrees. It can carry Perry out into battle. It's a slow wind, he gets there eventually. British open fire with their long guns, and for 2 hours, the Lawrence will take a pounding, largely by itself, because the Niagara has held back. Perry will fire his carronades, they're in range. However, all the guns on his side they can shoot at the British are disabled. What's he gonna do? Looks around, maybe someone spots it. The Niagara is moving forward. At that notice, Perry jumps into a longboat, has his a few men row him over to the Niagara, where he takes command, adds more sail, and sails right for the British line. This is the oh shoot moment for the British. Perry just got a brand new boat. Three important things are happening to the British right now. They have damaged ships. They have many of their sailors are actually soldiers because the British didn't have enough men to fight, sail all their ships and fight them. And every single captain and first officer of every British vessel is killed or wounded. Damaged ships, junior officers, soldiers. These three things collide, which actually causes the Detroit and the Queen Charlotte to collide. As they're performing a maneuver to wear ship, they're gonna turn around. Basically, if they've been fighting the US with their left side all day, they're gonna turn around and use their right side to fight the US. However, they're stuck together. They're sitting ducks now. Just remember when I talked about that bar shot and chain shot, taking out rigging and that maneuver? This is the same thing. Those British sailors, soldiers, officers have one job now. Get their vessels cut apart so they can fight. Meanwhile, a hole has developed in the British line, and that is where Perry is going to sail. So Perry sails into the British line. He can shoot right and left, and he will hit British vessels. And what Perry says is half pistol range, he double shots his carronades. What does double shotting? That means putting two shots in it. A solid shot and maybe a grape shot. Half pistol range, you're looking at maybe 30 yards from the enemy. The British can hear what is going on the US ship. And those British sailors take it as they cut their vessels apart. They finally do get their vessels cut apart. However, it's too late. They've taken a pounding. Barclay, the British commander, was wounded once before and had come back on deck. He's wounded again. They start surrendering one by one. It's a huge victory for the U.S. The first fleet action in U.S. naval history, and it's won out here on Lake Erie. And the big part about it, we captured all of their vessels. None of them got away. So that's the quick history of the Carronade and the Battle of Lake Erie. I'd like to thank you for coming to our virtual Perry Education Today's and our Carronade talk today. I hope you guys can come visit us in the future. In the meantime, if you haven't checked them out, check out our uniform talk. Are you a nutcracker? Yes, funny names. Cooking demonstration, medical, tour of the monument, tour of our visitor center, many other programs. Check out our website for the schedule of these events. Thank you for using your national parks.